This is a list of the topics covered by this video, so you can quickly scroll through the video and find the topics you're interested in. Once you have your tune-in coefficients the way you want them in the PLC, don't forget to hit this button to copy them back into the project so you can save them with the project. For example, if I hit Read from Project, I see the saved project values are not what's currently in the PLC. If I hit Save Current PLC Values to the project, then read the project values, we see they're now the same. Notice the scope of these buttons. These are down here and don't change from tab to tab. That means one button press updates all of these tabs. This button is in here, so it only applies to the parameters on this tab. Each tab has its own button, if appropriate. You may have noticed as we went through our demos that the PID monitor icon changes. If it looks like this, then everything's great. If it has a red X through it, then it means you're not connected to the PLC, so you can't monitor anything. Finally, if you see a red exclamation point like this, it means there's an error in the PID loop. Speaking of errors, the PID dialogs are really good about error checking. For example, if I try to enter something below 100 milliseconds for the sample time, I get an error. But you can also write to this from ladder or even a data view where you may not have error checking. The good news is the Click PID watches your back and tells you if you did something wrong. Open this error dialog and you see that this PID loop has this error. Fix it and the error goes away. Did you notice that every PID dialog has these little address helpers to remind you where you can find every memory location that's associated with PID? But remember, these are my memory addresses. If you allocated a different block of memory, your addresses will be different. Beware that these are not status bits. They don't tell you what the current mode is or if AutoTune is running. They're request bits. For example, if you want to switch to auto mode in your ladder code, you would set this bit. Once the transition has been made, PID will clear the bit so you know it's done. There are separate bits to indicate the actual status of these guys. Same thing for this one too. One of the cool things about the Click PID is that all of the memory locations associated with PID are automatically given nicknames. I love that I don't have to type those in myself. Each nickname has the PID loop name, the type, and the name. And it also provides a comment for each memory location giving some more detail about what each one is. And the quickest way to see all of those nicknames is with the list view. You can view by category or memory location for each PID loop. And again, you see that every location has an automatically generated nickname and comment. Of course, you can change those anytime you want. By the way, this is why you were limited to 6 characters when you created the PID loop name in the PID setup dialog. That prevents these automatic nicknames from getting too long. The Click PID monitor can display an enormous amount of historical data, so there are several levels of scaling to help manage that. First, there's the plot interval duration. This is a plot interval, and it's currently 1 second wide. We're looking at a plot interval that's this many seconds after I started the PID monitor. I can scroll back to the beginning, or one interval at a time using these arrow keys. We can increase the duration of each of these intervals up to 60 minutes. So now we're looking at an hour of recorded data. You can also show up to 10 of these intervals at the same time, so now we're looking at 10 hours of data. Finally, you can zoom that out another 10 steps, so now we're looking at roughly 2 months of time here. And if I had over 2 months of data, I could even scroll through that. Very cool. You can also format and control the color of everything you see here. There's lots of flexibility here, so you can display things exactly the way you need them. Noise can really mess with AutoTune. This filter option allows you to add filtering to the process variable before it gets to the PID algorithm. Just remember that a 100 here says let 100% of the signal fidelity through. So the smaller the number, the more high frequency content will be filtered out. I typically find that a filtering number of around 20 works well for my projects, so start there and experiment. Just be sure to keep the number as large as possible. Aggressive filtering will slow down the PID response. Also, note that when you set up PID, you can leave filtering disabled. If you change your mind, simply set this bit via ladder or data view, and filtering will be enabled. So filtering filters the process variable before it gets to the PID stuff. Error deadband provides another kind of noise reduction, but it does it on the error signal. I envision the error deadband as a string. One end is tied to the error signal coming into the error deadband, and the other end is tied to the signal coming out. If the incoming error moves enough to pull the string taut, then the resulting signal moves. As long as the string is slack, the resulting error stays the same. Again, you want to keep this as small as possible, or it will slow down the PID response. This guy squares the error. So errors smaller than 1 get reduced, and large errors get amplified. That'll make your system less responsive to small errors, which helps reject low noise levels. Notice that this gets applied before the error deadband. You can limit the magnitude of the control output. Maybe you don't want your system to be able to go to the max possible value for safety reasons or to protect your machine. You can set that limit on both the high and the low end. And that works regardless, so it'll also prevent auto-tune from driving the system too hard. Just understand that this isn't rescaling the output. It's cutting off portions of the output range. The freeze bias option helps you optimize your PID tuning by preventing the integral term of the PID equation from getting out of control when there are large differences between a set point and a process variable. It's worth spending time to understand this because it gives you better insight into how PID works. So rather than make this video any longer than it already is, I push this topic off to its own little bonus video. When you switch from manual mode to auto mode, what happens to the process? Well, let's switch to manual mode, move the set point away from the process variable, and then switch to auto mode. And as expected, PID goes to the max output to try and get the process variable to the set point as fast as possible. In our temperature demo, that's no big deal because things move so slowly. But if you have a fast-moving, massive machine, going straight to full output when switching to auto mode could be dangerous, or it could damage the machine. That's what bumpless mode is for. It forces the set point to whatever the process variable is, so there's no sudden bump in output, which allows you to switch to auto mode without having to worry about the machine going crazy. For example, I'll switch back to manual mode and make sure there's a good separation between a process variable and a set point. I'll bring up a data view and switch to bumpless mode. Now when we enter auto mode, the set point was automatically forced to be the same level as the process variable, so PID wouldn't see any need to make a large change in the output. Now we can gradually raise the set point in a controlled manner to keep the system from creating a hazardous situation. Now I know you're watching these videos because you don't want to read the help file, but I want to encourage you to take a quick spin through the PID section. It's really well done, and it'll give you even more insight into how the Qlik PID stuff works, especially this one that gives you a good top-level overview of how it all fits together. Click here to see all of the videos in this series. Click here to learn about Automation Direct's free support options, and click here to subscribe to our YouTube channel so you'll be notified when we publish new videos.